If a society governs itself completely independently, outside the interference of the state, then there is no way you can talk about the structures that come into being as being just or unjust. They are changing according to the localities, they change according to how people perceive it, they change according to certain criteria they use for the moment, and so on and so forth. In other words, these societies are not founded on any principles. And this is the fundamental perversity of Western political thinking. Whether it is about law or whether it is about normative political philosophy, they believe that society has to be founded on principles. Indians, on the other hand, think the society is not founded on anything. It founds itself, it is its own foundation, but principles are founded on society. And I think, in some senses, even Ambedkar, and definitely Gandhi had an insight into that. And that's the reason why I submit, at least that's my guess, why has there been no serious political thinking in India for the last 300 years, even after independence? And the big JNU intellectuals, what are they doing? They're simply reproducing John Rawls, Robert Nozick, Jeremy Waldron, and so on and so forth. They're not producing anything new. Why? Because we don't intuitively understand even the notion of politics that West has brought forth. We just simply reproduce them in seminars, that's all. We cannot think about it. So I think that the challenge for us today, this generation and the subsequent generations, is not simply reproduce John Rawls in India, like the JNU people and the Delhi University people do, but to really start thinking about different ways of organizing society. Why do we need democracy if state does not intervene? Is it not possible to build a society where state has absolutely no role to play? They did it for 2000 years in India, obviously. Why can we not reproduce it? Is it because of the nature of modern societies? Has it become too complex for such kind of societies, such kind of states? Now, these are the issues that are facing us. Not solve redistribution problem of primary goods in John Rawls' theory of political justice.
I have a question. And talking sometimes on one issue and talking sometimes on another issue is amounting to self-contradiction and ambiguity. This is one. And another question is, the issue of social justice that Ambedkar raised was the larger issue than reservation. But the Indian politics has reduced the whole social justice, the question of social justice, to the level of reservation. And that has been degenerated, as you said, that has been perverted in its implementation. So for this, Ambedkar is not responsible. He is not implementing these reservations. So these are all the questions you have to clarify.
He is not contradictory because he spoke about different things. See, he spoke about many things more. He spoke about inequality of women. He spoke about constituent assemblies. He spoke about all kinds of strikes. He spoke about Gandhism. He spoke about religion. Speaking about it, am I clear?
No, sir.
I'm not clear.
See,
the question he raised is of social justice.
Yeah.
Social justice.
He doesn't raise a question of social justice.
No, he was talking about
which India is, which says the following. You will be rewarded not according to your performance, but according to where you're born. So let's take two individuals, A and B. A is born in a higher caste, B is born amongst a scheduled caste, let's say. A reasons as follows. No matter what my performance is, it will not be rewarded. So if he is a rational human being, which is the assumption I'm making, that if both A and B are rational, he will say, it makes no sense for me to expend energy in order to learn more and perform better because it will not anyway be recognized. Why is it rational? Because it will be wasted effort. So, he does not learn, he doesn't perform well, he becomes incompetent. The person from B, scheduled caste, reasons as follows. No matter whether I perform or not, I'll be rewarded. So it is irrational of me to spend 10 hours studying in textbooks, instead I'll go eat, chase after girls, do whatever I feel like, enjoy my life basically. I'm exaggerating a bit. Because in any way I'm going to be rewarded. If he's a rational human being, which B is also a rational human being, he also does not put in the effort required to learn competence and perform and acquire knowledge. So the policy of reservation encourages both A and B to be inefficient, to be ignorant, and to be unproductive for different reasons. Such a society is going to collapse. But that's exactly the society that's being built in India on the basis of reservation. Isn't it perverse? A society which gives rewards to incompetency, inefficiency, and ignorance.
Do you say?
Did you understand my problem first? Okay.
But do you think that the reservation has totally has resulted in total inefficiency?
It has to, if it is rational. If our human beings are rational, it has to.
Yes, sir, but what you are telling is, it is a question of political theory.
It's a question of logic.
Yes.
Absolutely. It's a question of logic. That's what I'm saying. It leads to irrational consequences. Yeah. That's all I said. It's perverse, isn't it? I mean, if an institution, imagine, Kumapu University says, the more ignorant you are, the more inefficient you are, the more unproductive you are, I'm going to reward you. This university is going to collapse in about 2 decades. Look what's happening to India today. Look at the government services. Look at the public industries. Why do they want to privatize them, do you think? Yeah.
And he was not for reservations.
So,
the first constitution of India did not have any word like reservations. Only by way of amendment to the constitution, reservation was introduced thanks to the pressure of Nehru and Congress party. Not because of amendment. He was supposed to.
So, see, if you're simply telling me there is injustice in India, you're right. I'm not saying any. Of course, there is tremendous injustice in India. Who says otherwise? There is waste also, and so on. I'm not defending, I'm not saying India is an embodiment of justice. I didn't say that.
But